I like Kanye.
Yeah, me too.
Well, he's sampled a lot of our stuff.
Oh yeah, man. I know.
God, I thank God for him. Oh yeah, I've met him a couple of times. Every time he see me, he say, "Man, give me a better rate, man. Give me a better rate on them track." I say, "Hey, it's all right with me."
How you doing? I'm Carvin Hagens, and we're here with Mr. Kenny Gamble, the myth, the legend, the icon. Man, he's the unofficial mayor of Philadelphia.
Uh-oh.
If that make any sense. So, Mr. Gamble.
How you doing, brother?
First of all, you already know how I look up to you, and my entire career is really based off of your career.
Right.
And I'm still I'm trying to catch up, but I got a long road ahead of me. But in the meantime, I'm moving in increments. So we're here because we have this great show called Every Song Has a Story. And the songs that you've created are so impactful. We were talking earlier, songs affected me at 4 years old that I blew my mind, like singing. So one of the songs that I would like to talk to you about is Me and Mrs. Jones.
Wow, okay.
Me and Mrs. Jones, we got a thing.
Can you please tell me the inspiration behind Me and Mrs. Jones?
Well, first of all, before I even get started, man, we all have people that inspire us, you know, through life. And I've had quite a few people who were my mentors, and the guy who really helped me along was a gentleman, his name was Jerry Ross. And Jerry was the person who showed me the different formats with songs, you know, like you got a verse and you got a chorus. And so, you know, I wouldn't be here today without those who helped me, man. And it's an honor that you would even consider myself. And, of course, I know when you say me, you're talking about Huff also.
Because, absolutely.
Because it's Gambling Huff.
Yes.
And, you know, just like you mentioned, Me and Mrs. Jones, just about every day. It was called the Schubert Building then. It's called the Miriam Theater now. Huff and I, we had an office on the sixth floor in the Schubert Building. We would go downstairs to get a little lunch just about every day. This brother from Jersey, we used to sit in the same booth. They would have the same young lady would come in every day, and could have been his daughter, could have been his niece, or whoever it could be. But Huff and I said, "Oh, that's his girlfriend," you know? So we were saying, "Well, who is Mrs. Jones?" We gave her that name, Mrs. Jones. We wrote that song based on everything they did. She would walk in boots. She'd sit down and talk to him for a while, go over and play their favorite songs on the jukebox. Well, the jukeboxes in those days.
Right.
And Huff and I would be sitting there and be soaking it all in. They would be there for about an hour or so, whatever, and then he would leave and she would leave. She would go her way. And he would go his, and then the next day, tomorrow, we meet at the same time. That was basically the story. But when we got back upstairs into our office, we started playing some chords. I started playing chords. Huff was playing some chords on the piano. And we say, "Me and Mrs. Jones, we got a thing going on." The key to it was that we both know that it's wrong, but it's much too strong to let it go now. It's the lyrics and the music together that make it. Then the verses was, we meet every day at the same cafe. That's what these people were doing, you know. A lot of men could relate, and women who participated in that kind of relationship, because a lot of people do have those kinds of relationships, you know.
Yeah.
That song was made for the artist Billy Paul. Billy, he had a unique sound. We were all friends, and Billy put his little thing to it. I mean, because he was unique. And that was the chemistry. When that chemistry gets together, you got a great song, you got fun all in it, you know, and then you get the right artist at the right time. But when that song came out, it was an instant hit. I mean, everybody, most guys that I know, they've had a Mrs. Jones sometime in their life, you know what I mean?
Yes.
Whether it goes the distance or, you know, you have a friend or whatever the case might be. And women too, women do the same thing, you know?
Yeah.
Well, that's what that was.
We gotta be extra careful.
same cafe, the same time. And we're gonna hold hands like we used to. We're gonna talk it over, talk it over.
A lot of people don't know that Mr. Lou Rawls was not from here, but you guys gave him everything that he needed to become who he was. And I remember him having the Lou Rawls specials on TV back in the day. He really came in the game strong, but everything that was behind him was fully grown. Yeah. So, but that one song that he had, and again, I was a little bit older when it came out, but the conversation that came from this song, it was, nowadays we say gangster, right?
Right.
I guess back in the day they say pimp. I don't know. Whatever. The way the language was, it was a man so sure of himself. That song, You'll Never Find.
You'll never find.
You'll never find. As long as you live, someone who loves you tender like I.
Lou Rawls was another one of those artists that was so unique. And he had two, three different careers. Lou Rawls was the guy singing on Sam Cooke's albums way back in the 50s. And I knew Lou Rawls had a bass because I used to have a record shop down on Broad and South. And Lou Rawls had an album out called Tobacco Road. He was unique because he was a rapper. He was a singer rapper long before rapping came along, you know. And Jimmy Bishop, who was the general manager and one of the most popular disc jockeys in Philadelphia, he was working with us at the time. And Lou Rawls had just gotten out of his contract. So Bishop asked me, he said, what do you think he could do with Lou Rawls? I said, I don't know. I said, well, let's try it. I said, because I love his voice, you know what I mean? So Lou came in, and he was ready to go. He was a real professional, you know what I mean? He reminded me of Jerry Butler. You know, we recorded Jerry Butler, too, years and years ago. And me and Huff, we usually would be very well prepared for an artist when they come in. What we would do is write maybe 10, 15 songs. I said, you know, we have never worked with an artist like Lou Rawls because he was really, when you say adult contemporary, he was really an adult artist. And we caught him pretty much at the right time. You'll never find, that's like you going through a breakup or whatever, and then you tell somebody, hey, you're gonna never find nobody like me to put up with all your mess and whatever, you know. And that's pretty much what that song was trying to say. Is that you're gonna miss my loving, you know what I mean? Although you know you're bleeding inside, you say, I wish you'd take me back.
Yeah.
But, and the thing with that song that I thought was really great was the notes that we put into that melody to bring out that baritone sound in his voice. Yeah. You'll never find. Mm-hmm. And then, on top of that, Huff playing the melody behind doo 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 doo, you see? And so man, I'm telling you, we had so much fun. Some of those love songs, you know, they like heartbreakers, you know what I mean? And they remind you of a time when you say, man, I was really going through it, or my friend over here was going through it. But one thing for sure, when you get a good song and a great artist together, it's like, it's magic. Yeah. You know, and so Lou Rawls was one of those artists that song fit him like a glove.
Some of the songs that I write are like my personal experiences. So it's some things, of course, you got to leave the names out. You don't want to get sued.
Protect the innocent.
You got to protect the innocent.
But that's with me, too. See, I leave the names out. I don't talk about, you know, not in the songs, but they know who they are.
Right.
When they hear the song. See, you wrote this song about me. And that's the best way, really, to write a song is about an experience that you or maybe your friends or somebody around you are going through because...
Yeah.
That's how it goes, you know?
Yeah, it's like a form of relief.
Yeah, it's like therapy to me.
Yeah.
It was like therapy, because I used to come in and sit down and I mean, I got so many songs and stuff written on little pieces of paper everywhere.
This record right here blew me away, and I had to become an adult to really understand the song. Uh-huh. But everything about it, you know, as a kid, you listen and you singing the song, Cowboys and Girls, right? That record, again, amazing record, on top of the fact that the way he sings that record,
Lil Sonny.
It almost feels like he's intoxicated, but it feels like he's in pain and reminisce. Like he got all of those emotions caught up in that record. And I love that record.
I remember when I used to play shoot 'em up,
bang bang, baby.
Intruders, you know. I mean, I was thinking about a month or so ago, I said, man, if I could just work with them one more time. Everybody loved the Intruders. We just hadn't come up with that right song yet, you know. And then one day when we were writing over in Jersey, and went over to Huff's house, and then we started talking about how you develop as a young man. You'd be, you know, when we was little, an imaginary horse you're riding, you know, you're shooting people and whatever. And then the girls, you know, you'd be pushing them around, and you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, you grow up and you look at that same girl, you say, man, can't push her around no more. She's beautiful, you know? He says, I remember when we used to play shoot 'em up, bang, bang. It was beautiful because the Intruders had such incredible harmony as a group. They had great harmony with Bird, Little Sonny, Big Sonny, and Phil. The funny thing about the Intruders too, if I must add, I knew of the Intruders when I was in high school. I went to West Philly High School. There was a guy, a disc jockey, his name was Rockin' Robin. And he used to play the Intruders all the time. And I used to listen for that record. I used to love their sound. I said, and even then, when I was in high school, I said, man, one day, I said, I'm going to work with the Intruders. I didn't know where they were. Rockin' Robin gave us a show on 40th and Gerard. And he had the Intruders and a couple other groups, Cruisers and whatever. So when I went down there, the Intruders came on and the place went wow. I mean, you know, I'm just graduating high school. And I was starting to go down to the Schubert building a little more because I started working at Jefferson Hospital. One day I walked in there and the Intruders was in the office that Huff was working in. And because Huff was working with a guy's name was Leroy Lovett, who was a wonderful dude, by the way. Mm-hmm. And he was an arranger. But when I walked in there and seen the Intruders, I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe that I was in the same room with the Intruders.
Wow.
And then we got to talking, we got to working. I said, man, I got some songs, you know what I mean? And just a whole series of events that took place with us starting the record label. I mean, it's just unbelievable. And it's a joy to just be talking about it. It brings back memories, you know? And the one thing that we always tried to do was to encourage everybody that was working with us to write songs. Write songs and learn the business. Because the beautiful part of this business is that if you write a song, and if it's a hit, you can have revenue coming from that song on the business side of things. You can have revenue coming in for your life and the life of your children, your children's children. I mean, it's constantly changing, you know. From Cowboys to Girls. Wow. That was a great one.
Blessing, man. It's a blessing that a gift of words could finance you for the rest of your life.
Yeah. It can. You know, it's hard work though, because you're taking a piece of your soul and giving it to the world.
Yeah.
For people to share, you know. And I always used to tell all the artists, I said, listen, I said, it's the girls. I said, who's in these concerts? It's the girls. Who's screaming? It's the girls. So let's do music that's going to satisfy these girls.
That's right.